we make these devices called microfluidic devices that are kind of like, you know, you can sort of picture the way integrated circuits made it possible to do a lot of electronic computations in a very small footprint. And that kind of led to this revolution in computer science hardware. For us, what we do is we use these, we make these microfluidic devices that allow us to do like fluidic computations in high throughput in very small footprints. So now what we can do is we can do
fluidic computation.
Right. So, you know, normally if you were going to do an experiment in cell in biology, you sort of picture like test tubes and like petri dishes and like big things. And if you wanted to do 1,000 reactions, you need these giant expensive robots. And so what we've been doing is we've been using this approach where we can create these like tiny devices that instead of using like 5 milliliters of fluid for each reaction, we use about a nanoliter. And these devices make it possible to use, you know, fewer reagents. So everything is low cost. We can automate things on these devices without the use of expensive robots. And now, you know, the main power of these technologies is that they allow us to make 1,000 measurements in the amount of time and cost that it used to take to make one in biology. And now I think that that means that we can generate data at a scale that allows us to quantitatively test predictions from our colleagues in ML, right? So, you know, you all need ground truth. You need some ground truth measurement to assess what's going on. And you can't just have one or two. You need enough that you can, you know, do some sort of regression to figure out where is your model successful and where is it failing. And so, you know, our job is to make measurements of like 1,000 things really quantitatively, where we can interface back and forth with ML people to test those predictions, revise and refine those models. And, you know, hopefully try and use some of these ML predictions to learn new physics. That's what we want to do.
That's so cool. So like, what would be something that would happen at that tiny scale? Like, what are you like literally like putting like a protein in there and watching what happens? Like, yeah, I don't know. Can you explain like exactly what goes into that?
Exactly. So, okay, here's two examples of some platforms we've developed. So we've been working really closely with Dan Hirschlag, and he's like an enzymologist. And so one type of protein that we're interested in is enzymes. And enzymes are like, they underpin all of our metabolism, right? They make it possible to do chemical reactions that would never happen in the absence of an enzyme. So they're important both for our cells. They're the tools people use in modern molecular biology. You use them to make libraries for sequencing. People use them in, you know, you use them when you do your laundry, right? Enzymes are the things that like bust up stains on your clothes. And we still don't really know how the sequence of an enzyme specifies its function. So one thing that we can do now is just like sort of, a, I guess, you know, DNA, like the Moderna vaccine, right? Everybody sort of heard, now we can make this mRNA vaccine and we can program it to make something that we want. We can create little pieces of DNA, each of which specifies a protein we want to make. We can use a robot so that we spot bits of this DNA in an array. So we have like 1,000 little spots and we know the program encoded by the DNA in each spot. We could take one of these devices that we make that has little chambers and align them to the spots. And then there's sort of this magical mixture of like all of the stuff that you need to turn DNA into RNA and protein. The companies sell. It's like you just buy this little tube that has, you know, the polymerase you learned about in high school biology, the ribosome that makes the protein, all that stuff. We push it into these little chambers.
And that fits in a nanoliter?
Yeah.
So the nanoliter is not too, it all fits.
Yeah, nanoliter, a nanoliter is like, okay, your hair, a hair strand is like 100 microns. Each of the chambers in these devices is about the diameter of your hair and the height of a tenth of your hair, right? So we use like a lot of the machinery that people use for lithography to make these integrated circuits. We use that same, all the same equipment to make these like tiny devices. And now we can make a little bit.
I guess I see the integrated circuit analogy.
Yeah, exactly. So we do, we really do use a lot of the same equipment, except for now, instead of pushing electrons around, we're actually pushing fluid that contains molecules in different ways within these devices. So we can make each one of these enzyme variants in each chamber. And now we can quantitatively ask, when you make this mutation, how does it affect the ability of this enzyme to catalyze the reaction it's supposed to catalyze? So that's like sort of, that's an example of one of the things that we do. And it, and the reason why you would want to do it is this might help us classify variants in the human population for whether or not they're likely to compromise function and cause disease. It could also maybe help us generate new enzymes that eat up environmental waste or design new enzymes to do things that we want to do. One other example, I guess, of something that we do is historically, when you've looked at a population of cells, let's say from a tumor, we've ground up all those cells and we've asked, what's the behavior of that population of cells? Within all of those cells, maybe there's one or two rare cells that's resistant to a drug. And when we treat a patient with that drug, those one or two cells are going to proliferate and drive treatment failures, right? So we need a way where instead of like looking at all of the cells mashed up together, we want to be able to profile the cells one by one. So another way, another technology that we're using that this field, microfluidics, allows you to do is we can actually put every cell in a tiny droplet, like a little, basically a little water in oil droplet that serves as a tiny compartment where we can interrogate that cell by itself without looking at all of its neighbors at the same time. And so again, those are little, those droplets are like a nanoliter, right? And we can look at a million cells individually at once in their own little nanoliter compartments.
Thanks for watching this clip. You can see the full episode on our YouTube channel. And you can join our friendly Slack community with over 4,000 ML engineers to participate in paper reading groups, AMAs, and other fun events.